30,000 students have wrestled with issues ranging from sustainable development and climate change to terrorism, extreme poverty, and the scourge of HIV and AIDS. We hope that by your participation in these debates, that you as audience members and debaters will become active citizens and agents for change, seeking justice and human rights for all. Concern Worldwide would like to thank the adjudicators, teachers, and teams for making this debate possible. The motion for the House today is that governments in the Global South must actively discourage rapid urbanization. Our adjudicators for today are Chief Adjudicator Jennifer Gillen. Jenny was a Concerned Debates finalist in 2016, competing on the behalf of St. Joseph's College, Lucan. Since competing in the debates, she has completed a degree in law with history at the University College Dublin, while continuing to work with Concern Active Citizenship on a volunteer basis, assisting with social media, events, and of course, adjudicating debates. In August 2021, Jenny graduated from Leiden University in the Netherlands with a master's degree in public international law, where her research focused primarily on the international environmental law and international humanitarian law. With each passing year, Jenny continues to be inspired by the knowledge, talent, and passion of the debate's participants and never fails to come away from a debate without gaining unique insight into the motion at hand. Lizzie Noon. Lizzie has been working with schools on global citizenship education and campaigning for 24 years. She has worked for Worldwide Global Schools for 9 years and has worked with Concern for 15 years previous to this and remains a loyal supporter of their work. She has headed up 3 EU-funded projects, Stop Child Labour 1 and 2 and Food Right Now. She represented Ireland on the European Development Education Forum for 4 years and has been a member of the steering group of the Global Campaign for Education, Stop Climate Chaos, and Act Now 2015 for many years. And Alex Swan. Alex is a retired police officer, presently an Ulster Unionist councillor on Lisburn and Castlereagh City Council. Alex is particularly interested in planning issues and healthcare provision, especially in relation to mental health and suicide prevention. Thank you for adjudicating today. I will now pass you over to the captain of the proposition to begin today's debate.
A chahirlik, a wultori, a huina ushla, a winter colosta rida, August on loch trasora, Davor Mahasa. Ismisha Kilno Toma, the captain of this colosta rida team, and I am here in the company of my colleagues to passionately propose the motion governments in the global south must actively discourage rapid urbanization. Now, O'Harda, let me begin by defining the motion. The Global South refers to developing regions in South America, Africa, and Asia. Britannica defines urbanization as the process by which large number of people become permanently concentrated in small areas. I would like to draw your attention to the key word of this motion, rapid urbanization. While we acknowledge that urbanization is not altogether a bad thing, that is not what we are focusing on here today. Today, we need to understand that the uncontrolled and unplanned expansion of cities brings profound social, environmental, and health risks. My team and I will now illustrate that governments should encourage sustainable long-term urbanization, instead of the ad hoc, unplanned, and dangerous approach promoted by the opposition. Our second speaker, Eve, will demonstrate how rapid urbanization has never been positive, detailing examples throughout history and explaining how the long-term consequences are still being felt today. She will show how the alternative solution of constant, sustainable development is far more beneficial. Sean, our third speaker, will discuss the socioeconomic impact of unplanned urbanization, poverty, the growth of slums, and lack of essential infrastructure. He will explain how this dramatically decreases the quality of life for city dwellers and why this should not be promoted. Finally, Elise will focus on the environmental impact. You will hear her explain how climate change and air pollution have devastating effects on developing countries and how these are being exacerbated by unplanned urbanization. But before you hear my team's arguments, I'm proposing a point of my own. How rapid urbanization leads to many health and sanitation problems. It is striking that today, almost 2.3 billion city dwellers lack adequate sanitation, according to World Resources Institute. The problem is particularly acute in sub-Saharan Africa and South Asia, i.e. the Global South, where 62% and 43% respectively of the urban population live in slums and are faced with unacceptable levels of worm infections, cholera, and diarrhea. According to the World Health Organization, deaths from contagious diseases are concentrated in urban areas in the Global South. And why does this problem exist? The UN tells us that it's due to the rapid, unplanned growth of cities that the opposition is trying to promote. 62% of human waste is unsafely managed in the Global South, as stated in the World Resources Report 2019. Take, for example, the urban neighborhood of Kosovo in Nairobi, Kenya. 95% of residents defecate in communal facilities where untreated human waste drains directly into their drinking water. This is only one of the many examples of neighborhoods in the Global South that have suffered due to unsafe, unsustainable urbanization. A case study by Tier Fund in Burkina Faso shows that the decentralization of urban areas led to both improved sanitation and an increase in economic growth. This is mainly due to less money being spent on curing preventable diseases. From the examples I've outlined, it's clearly evident that the only way to ensure this is through actively discouraging rapid urbanization and promoting long-term sustainable development. A win-win approach for both the economy and health. I urge you to propose this motion. Gurmaine Mogad.
Ian, you speak about human waste as a problem, but what is your solution? To ignore it. There comes a point where we need to stop pulling people out of the river. We need to go upstream and find out why they're falling in. A quote from Desmond Tutu that highlights the importance of dealing with challenges with a rational mindset. Ladies and gentlemen, adjudicators. My name is Claire, and I'm here today with my teammates, Megan, Luke, and Shane, to vigorously oppose the motion, governments in the Global South must actively discourage rapid urbanization. Allow me to define the motion. The phrase Global South refers broadly to the regions of Latin America, Asia, Africa, and Oceania. It is one of a family of terms, including third world and periphery, that denotes regions outside of Europe and North America, mostly low income and often politically or culturally marginalized. According to Oxford Dictionary, the term actively is defined as in a way that involves doing something. Oxford Dictionary defines the term discourage as to cause someone to lose confidence or enthusiasm. Urbanization, according to nationalgeographic.org, is a process through which cities grow and higher populations come to live in the city. In the Global South, we see urbanization happening at a rapid rate, outstripping the capacity for cities to provide services and infrastructures. Kian, rapid urbanization is happening and it can't be stopped. Trying to stop it would be like King Canute trying to hold back a tidal wave. We on the opposition believe that the Global South would be far better off putting in place the infrastructure to serve the growing population instead of allowing informal unplanned areas like sprawling slums, such as in Rio, Calcutta, Nairobi, and Dodoma. My teammate Luke will discuss the importance of logistics of urbanization, mega educational opportunities in cities, and finally, Shane will examine about sanitation in these countries. Keen, investing in cities is central to securing the next stage of Africa's development, according to the World Bank. Cities are engines of economic growth, already accounting for more than two-thirds of economic output in most developed countries. Strong city planning will be essential in managing these and other difficulties as the world's urban areas swell, according to nationalgeographic.com. Putting in place the infrastructure and services is a fundamental part of economic prosperity. You are simply ignoring and negating these problems. A good informed plan is required so that more people can have a stable financial income and a healthier lifestyle. Kian, we want to draw policymakers' attention to the fact that countries having more than 60% of their population in urban areas are expected to achieve 50% more millennium development goals on average than those with urbanization rates of 40% or less. Since about 2015, more than 75% of the world's population lives in the Global South. It is projected that by 2025, the urban population of the Global South will be 3.75 billion, which is 54.3% of the total population of the Global South, according to Oxford Research Encyclopedia.com. Kian, you cannot convince me that actively discouraging urbanization will solve the problems that you suggest. Kian, do you want to be the one that contributed to children having to live a life under unsanitary conditions, such as children working in dumpsters trying to make money that lead to serious long-term illnesses due to informal unplanned areas? Some people don't like change, but you need to embrace change if the alternative is disaster. Elon Musk. This is why it's fundamental that this motion is defeated. Do you want to be the one to tell the children why their mothers and fathers don't have enough income to provide enough money to provide enough food on their plates? Imagine going to one of these arid countries and seeing these children who have to walk miles just to collect cloudy, opaque water saturated with grit and disease instead of going to school where they should be. People are going to continue to fall into the river of poverty and disease, sickness and death in these developing countries in the Global South, unless governments start putting in the services and infrastructure that is needed. I beg you to oppose.
Good afternoon, Chairperson, adjudicators, members of the opposition, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Eve. I am the second speaker for the proposition, and alongside my teammates today, I will be passionately proposing the motion that governments in the Global South must actively discourage rapid urbanisation. In my speech, I will focus on our experiences of rapid urbanisation in the past, present and future. I will highlight how humanity has been and continues to be negatively impacted by urbanisation across the globe. Clear will have you believe that slow, planned urbanisation has benefited many countries, but there appears to be a misunderstanding in the title of this debate. Urbanisation is all well and good until it's rapid, unplanned and ultimately unsustainable. That is what we are proposing this discourage, and that is where the issues are found. Firstly, let us look at our past and what we can and should learn from it. The British Industrial Revolution resulted in rapid urbanisation. In 1760, the founding of mechanical works, machines and trade led to a huge increase or a boom in the British economy. And the economic benefits were experienced by some. However, this came at a huge price. Britain experienced a huge growth in class divide between the rich and the poor, especially in the standard of living. The period was responsible for the pejorative term Dickensian conditions, when we describe the squalor that some people have to live in nowadays. According to the British Economic Library, British economic historians agree that the distribution of income became more unequal between 1790 and 1840. Socially, the working class suffered greatly between poor working conditions to child labour to disease spreading swiftly through the towns of England. BritishHistory.co.uk states that the average life expectancy of a labourer during the Industrial Revolution was 22 years of age, whereas the average 22-year-old in Ireland nowadays is still relying on mammy for pocket money. This is a prime example of how rapid urbanisation has not been successful in the past. So how is rapid urbanisation different to how it was all those years ago? The fact of the matter is that it's not. As my partner Keane mentioned earlier, rapid urbanisation deteriorates the health and standard of living of the working class. We've seen this happen in the past in Britain, and we still see it now in the present in places such as Dubai, which could be considered as the epitome of urbanisation, modern architecture and rapid change. According to Worldometer, the population of the United Arab Emirates has more than quadrupled from about 73,000 in 1970 to over 10 million in 2021. The class divide is clearly evident between the slums and the mansions. The poverty rates in the UAE currently stand at 19.5%, according to American philanthropist Clint Morgan, which is a shockingly high number for what is to be considered such a rich country. Minimumwage.org states that Dubai actually has no minimum wage and many people are underpaid. My final example is the city of Lima in Peru. Lima has become wealthy due to its exports. Associated Press News has said that the capital's economy has more than doubled in size in the last two decades. And this has no doubt affected the population of Lima greatly. 19% of Lima's population have been described as living in absolute poverty by the United Nations Development Programme, meaning that they survive on less than $1 a day. That is one-fifth of the population, one in five people surviving on what is the equivalent of 88 cents a day. Rapid urbanisation is clearly an issue in society today. Claire, your reference or comment on solutions, I have some for you here. There are definitely ways to tackle this issue while still allowing a country to urbanise. The key word we need to remove is rapid, as that's what leads to the intense poverty and extreme social class systems. To slow down the rate of urbanisation or reduce the negative impacts, we must build urban planned towns and cities. It's also vital that we focus more on building up rather than building out. This reserves our rural areas, and we can see how this benefited many American cities such as New York. My final method of decreasing the high rates of rapid urbanisation is using alternative transport systems to ensure less air pollution, such as cable cars, trams, electric buses, and even including cycle lanes on more roads. Rapid urbanisation has failed humanity in the past. It continues to fail humanity in the present and will continue to fail us all into the future. For these reasons, it should not only be discouraged, but actively fought against by all. I urge you to carry the motion. Thank you.
The prop would paint you a picture of a dystopia, of overcrowded urban slums and desolate rural villages where the only residents are the tumbleweeds passing through. This is what will happen if we don't plan, if we try to change the waves instead of learning to surf. Rapid and efficient does not mean unplanned. The Global South doesn't have all the time in the world. My name is Luke Lane. I'm here today to vehemently oppose this motion. According to ActiveSustainability.com, we are more than 7.7 billion and will continue growing until 2050 by at least another 2 billion. Discouraging urbanization is not the answer to overpopulation. That's a different debate, Eve. Kian, over the next 30 years, virtually all of the world's population growth is expected to be in the urban areas of the developing world. According to Elsevier.com, the eradication of extreme poverty and hunger will rely largely on how developing countries develop their cities. Cities are currently home to nearly half the world's population, and over the next 30 years, most of the 2 billion plus increase in global population is expected to occur in urban areas in the developing world. Keane, it is morally reprehensible to suggest that governments in the global south should actively discourage rapid urbanization. It is morally irresponsible, and it will perpetuate the problems that Prop seem to care so passionately about, such as the environmental crisis, inequity due to lack of education, and stymie economic growth. Today, almost 400 cities contain a million people or more, and 70% of them are found in the developing world. If this motion is passed, global governments will be like ostriches with their heads in the sand. Like King Canute trying to push back the tidal wave, they're going to be overwhelmed with the crashing wave of poverty, disease, and the climate crisis. Keane and Eve are ignoring the problem and offering no solution. Eve, urbanization has been a phenomenon from the earliest times of mankind. People migrate to cities for all sorts of reasons, looking for opportunity, trying to escape natural disasters, and being displaced by conflict. How do you suggest we stop them? This motion goes against SDG 11, which aims to make cities safe, resilient, and sustainable. As my teammate Claire has, and Shane will assert, if well managed, cities offer important opportunities for economic and social development. Shane will speak about using the biodigester to create energy from human waste, and Claire spoke about the importance of planning to avoid unplanned urban dwellings, giving rise to slums and pavement dwellers. As Claire has already stated, the World Bank has stated that investing in cities is central to securing the next stage of Africa's development. Eve, high population density is also good for minimizing the effect of man on local ecosystems. High population density typically implies lower per capita costs providing infrastructure and basic services. And despite the high rates of urban poverty that are found in many cities, urban residents on average enjoy better access to education and healthcare, as well as other basic public services such as electricity, water, and sanitation than people in rural areas, as my teammate Shane will elaborate. Elise, you speak about the environment, but are you aware of projects such as Via Verde, which has helped Mexico City in fulfilling SDG 11 by creating green spaces in urban environments such as highways using recycled materials, creating a circular economy and reducing air pollution? If this motion is passed, governments in the global south are simply ignoring the problems associated with overcrowding, poor sanitation, poor water and air quality, lack of education and social services. Rapid urban growth throughout the developing world has seriously outstripped the capacity of most cities to provide basic services for their citizens. Eve, we're not suggesting that everybody lives in the megacities the size of Sao Paulo, Mexico City, Beijing, or Lagos. Small cities will be fundamental to accommodating future population growth and economic prosperity. Small cities have time to address residents' basic infrastructure and service needs before the magnitude of the service gap becomes too great. As I've already stated, a report from the World Bank has stressed that investing in cities is central to securing the next stage of Africa's development. However, unlike cities in much of Asia and Latin America, in Africa, urbanization has become decoupled from economic development. The decline comes as a result of the undermining of institutional support for all aspects of scientific research, source B Cohen Technology and Society 2006. As my teammates Claire and Megan will stress, planning is key to avoiding unplanned informal urban sprawl. This motion is retrogressive. Like King Canute trying to hold back the waves, it is short-sighted and foolish. I want to end with a caveat. In the words of Roy Keane, if you fail to plan, then you are planning to fail. You can react retrogressively or respond progressively. I beg you to oppose.
Good afternoon, Chairperson, adjudicators, members of the opposition, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Sean, and here today, alongside my teammates, I'll be passionately proposing the motion: governments in the global south must actively discourage rapid urbanisation. My teammates have spoken about health issues and sanitation risks, and previous failures of rapid urbanisation. I will now discuss how rapid urbanisation means an increased need for development of more infrastructure. Also, how along with urbanisation comes increased living costs and big companies profiting off the poor. The opposition will have you believe that rapid urbanisation is a great opportunity for development, a great opportunity for people, and is a prime time to invest in a country, especially in the Global South. But ladies and gentlemen, we have seen this before. The richer North pumps money into rapidly growing countries and economies, but the money is put towards unsustainable and unreliable sectors of the economy. To reference my teammate Eve's point on the United Arab Emirates, its economy is simply based on oil. It too was once a heavily poor country. Then international investment was pumped into the economy. And now we are left in the position we are in today, a nation contributing to the world's climate crisis and ecological issues, as my teammate Elise will soon discuss. I'd also like to discuss the need for more infrastructure and how it is essential to increase rapid urbanisation. Transport, education, health, recreation, and housing. They're just some of the things needed when rapid urbanisation occurs. May I add, these do not come free by no means. In fact, these all come with hefty price tags for the taxpayers. An urban area simply cannot survive without any of the infrastructure I've previously mentioned. Take Ireland, for example. A children's hospital is now being constructed in Crumlin, now costing the Irish taxpayer between 2 billion and 4 billion euros. According to gov.ie, the Irish government has pumped 35 billion into transport alone. If this was to happen in the Global South, it would cost the many crippling economies billions of euro. And in fact, according to globalcitizen.org, they would simply not be able to provide basic infrastructure, such as education and health, let alone other infrastructure. Nigeria, which is one of the fastest growing urban areas, only spends 6 billion on transport. Claire, I'm delighted you mentioned the sprawling slums, the favelas in Brazil and the shanty towns in India, such as Derby, because according to BBC, they are simply a result of rapid urbanisation, migration and improper infrastructure. This is the reality. People simply fled to places like Rio de Janeiro. And unfortunately, this ramped up living costs and created much more poverty. And may I add, due to buildings being constructed so promptly in places like Sao Paulo, where urban planning was given no consideration, we are seeing masses of traffic congestion and mass health issues in the emerging youth. This is what rapid urbanisation causes, not a new lavish life, as I'm sure the opposition will portray. The economy should not be prioritised over people, but in these cases it is. Luke, to reference your comment on solutions, Eve has offered plenty of solutions, plenty of them. My next point is poverty. With rapid urbanisation comes privatisation and ramped up housing costs, leaving the rich in benefit and the poor at a disadvantage. We can already see examples of this in Brazil. There's complete division, almost a border between those in poor areas to those on the coastline who are wealthier. According to United Nations, rapid urbanisation is a formula for disaster and poverty. If the Global South were to see rapid urbanisation, it would completely cripple, and I mean cripple, the less off. Ladies and gentlemen, with the points above, I have highlighted that rapid urbanisation causes poverty, privatisation, and divides people into poorer rich. This is why governments in the Global South must actively discourage rapid urbanisation. Thank you.
The great aim of education is not knowledge, but action, Herbert Spencer. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Megan, and I'm here with my teammates, Claire, Luke, and Shane, to vehemently oppose the motion, governments in the Global South must actively discourage rapid urbanization. Urbanization is the single most important transformation taking place in Africa currently. Urbanization combats poverty by promoting economic development and job creation. Those jobs lead to more tax-paying citizens. These taxes pay for hospitals and schools and better, safer infrastructure. Better opportunities for children, a way for children to stay in school instead of having to drop out to help make rent. If children stay in school and make it to third level education, that increases the number of doctors or teachers that a country has to care for the population. Urbanization is breaking the poverty cycle for people, but Cian, it is imperative that the right policies and informed planning must be adopted to avoid urban slum type of sprawl. Governments should absolutely not be discouraging rapid urbanization. Instead, they should be trying to put in place the infrastructure that will ensure that children are not exploited due to their families' poverty and desperation. Did you know that according to ActionAid, 15 million people in the global south survive by scavenging waste? 15 million. Did you know that most of them are children trying to make money for food while their parents make money for rent? I found a case study on a little girl named Margaret who lives with her family just outside of Mozambique. Every day she wades through rubbish and broken glass and toxic waste, collecting scrap metal and plastic to sell to earn a living. She is 10 years old. She told reporters, "It's very dirty and there is a bad smell. I know there are very bad diseases I can catch here. I'm afraid of being cut by broken bottles, nails, or syringes." She is 10. What were you doing at 10, Cian? I was probably still playing with Barbies or running around the playground playing tag. That is what Margaret and all these other children who miss getting a childhood should be doing. They should have a playground which isn't a breeding ground for disease, where they don't have to fear for life-threatening illnesses that I didn't even know existed when I was 10. That story is from 2015. That makes Margaret our age, Sean, but I can't find out what happened to her. But I can make a very educated guess. Dumpsite life leaves women and girls vulnerable to violence and sexual abuse, even rape, but there is nowhere for them to go for healthcare or support. Children belong in school, not on rubbish dumps, and that is why urbanization is important. If urbanization is planned and informed, children will have hospitals they can go to if they get sick. It means jobs with better pay for adults so their children can stay in school, so they don't end up hunting for copper coins in piles of rotting rubbish. If the demographic needs of people are considered when planning, urbanization means infrastructure that can prevent so many children from living the nightmare that Margaret did. Giving children a proper education gives them a way out, a way to make a living for themselves when older, without the excess torture. Eve, a proper education is an opportunity for the future. Urbanization, if the democratic needs of the people are considered, then it is the answer to ensuring that all these children can benefit from their right to education, their right to safety, and their right to childhood. Planning like life skills for children, such as the life skills education or LSE sessions mentioned by Concerns Knowledge Matters, which helps give children a better understanding of the struggles they will face and how to navigate them in the safest manner possible. These sessions also gave them access to healthcare and recognized vocational practice, which is the leading reason to lack of jobs. The skills learned through carpentry, skills learned such as carpentry, were not learned from a recognized source, instead through an apprenticeship or a family business in remote rural areas, which if not recognized and registered, cannot be used as a reference and reduces the chance of employment. Planning for urbanization is key, Sean, for countries in the global south, for economic growth, for economic prosperity, and for economic independence, not discouraging it from happening at all. The story of King Canute shows that you cannot stop the tidal wave. It is all about responding to the problems of overcrowding, poor sanitation, poor energy needs, lack of education, and preparing for it accordingly while we still can. Before the wave comes and sweeps them aside with brutal force, you cannot stop the tidal wave, but you can learn to surf. John Kabat-Zinn, I beg you to oppose this motion.
Good afternoon, Chairperson, Adjudicators, members of the Opposition, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Elise, and today with my team, I'm proposing that governments in the Global South must discourage rapid urbanisation. I will further explain to you why rapid urbanisation is not something to promote by considering the environmental aspects of this discussion. I will focus on the areas of deforestation and air pollution, which are both crucial when assessing the issue of urbanisation. While I'm on the topic of the environment, Luke, you talk about these recycling projects that you can create, but it takes time and money, and which rapid urbanisation does not allow. You can't expect these poor South countries to come up with this money. As I've stated, urbanisation directly affects our environment and ecosystems. While you may think growing our cities is very effective for the future, the only limited benefactors in this phenomenon are people. We must think, however, about every other living creature on this country other than ourselves. The lungs of the world, the Amazon rainforest, spreads across six different less developed countries in South America. However, it is under severe deforestation as we speak. According to planetcitizen.com, Brazilian cities have doubled in population over the past decade, which is threatening the forest due to the rapid growth of towns and cities. Trees are cut down without a second thought just to make way for buildings. Philip Burnside, a researcher at the National Institute for Amazon Research, recently said that more population will result in more deforestation. Deforestation industries don't care about the wildlife living within the forests. This is why governments need to urgently reduce the speed of urbanisation. The opposition recommends planting trees and promoting wildlife, but this doesn't even begin to measure up to the intricate ecosystems that are embedded in the Amazon. I'm sure you will agree that a flock of wood pigeons does not meet the standards. It's crucial that urbanisation rates are reduced because we must protect our environment. Moving on to my second point, rapid urbanisation does not allow public service to catch up. As you mentioned, waste disposal. Megan, you talk about the waste that people are scourging through, but this is a direct result of rapid urbanisation. And Claire, you ask for solutions. We see solutions every day, such as proper waste collection. This is a solution. But as cities grow, we can't expect governments to keep up with all these demands. In fact, 63 million tonnes of waste is produced by India every single year, and only 12 million is properly treated. To move on to my second point, urbanisation does not allow public services to catch up. As my teammate Sean has previously mentioned, this causes people to use their own ways of private transport. So what does this mean for our environment? Well, firstly, this will result in more carbon emissions, which, as we already know, increases the rate of global warming due to the greenhouse effect. And secondly, it decreases air quality, especially in highly populated areas, such as Beijing. My teammate Keen has already highlighted the disadvantages to health that urbanisation causes. But I would like to emphasise that within 6 months of 2020, 49,000 people died in Beijing due to air quality, according to Greenpeace South Asia. Mask wearing was no strange sight to city dwellers in China, even before COVID, because air pollution had forced them to protect their health by these means. Unfortunately, for plants, trees and soil, wearing a mask is not an option. National Geographic reports that air pollution causes acid rain. When this falls, it changes the composition of soil, degrades the quality of rivers, lakes and seas, and can actually kill plants. In addition to deforestation, this is destroying any plant life that lives anywhere close to a city. Rapid urbanisation should be prevented for our environments for the future. This results in deforestation and air pollution, and that's just naming a few. And for these reasons, we need to put on the brakes. I urge you to propose the motion. Thank you.
Some people don't like change, but you need to embrace change if the alternative is disaster. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Shane, and I'm here to oppose the motion that governments in the Global South must actively discourage rapid urbanization. It is true that cities are a huge problem in terms of CO2 emissions, and informal and unplanned urban sprawl certainly isn't conducive to the environmental problem. According to an article by Nature.com, over 70% of the CO2 emissions of the world come from urban areas containing over half of the world's population. In 2016, according to worldometers.info, CO2 emissions rose by 4.5% in Bangladesh and 3.6% in Kenya. Furthermore, Delhi's annual CO2 emissions equate to a startling 69.4 million tons. These are appalling figures, so it's only natural to assume that rapid urbanization would lead to a significant increase in CO2 emissions. My teammate Luke has already talked about air quality, like the Beer Bridge project in Mexico. But let me ask you, does this justify neglecting people in the poorly developed southern countries of the world? In urban slums, congestion and poor hygiene increases exposure to disease. According to the WHO, 3/4 of all Liberians living in urban areas do not have access to improved sanitation facilities. They resort to open defecation or dispose of feces in plastic bags, calling them flying toilets. This is quite frankly appalling, as Kevin has stated. Now, you can see this as a disaster, or you can see this as an opportunity for economic growth and prosperity. For example, in Liberia, projects that combine latrine construction with the rehabilitation of existing structures. Allow me to show the proposition that rapid and unplanned do not necessarily go hand in hand. Rapid and planned can coexist together. They are not the same word or mutually exclusive. We are saying plan in advance. What is your alternative solution? Because you haven't offered one. Are you barring people from cities? How do you plan on enforcing that? Sean, you said Eve offered solutions. What solutions? We can use this human waste to create energy using biodigesters, for example. These produce biogas, which can be tapped and used as cooking gas and converted into electricity to light up a community with no real access to power. And the pressure of the gas can even fuel itself. As well as having benefits in terms of power sources, this system brings further benefits to these communities. For example, through filtration, water from the race can be reused, even if it's not potable. This water could be used to flush the toilets, further sustaining its own system, or any myriad of other uses, from washing clothes to watering crops. Ideas like this can provide so much for these communities: gas, electricity, even water. It would leave them less dependent on imported fossil fuels, which helps to reduce their carbon footprint. It can be a source of income, whilst also reducing the cost within the community. By making separate facilities for men and women, you can also make the lives of women and children in these communities safer. Eve, overcrowding is a huge problem. Eve, the world is overpopulated, and this is putting a huge strain on the Earth's resources. But to say that we should actively discourage urbanization in the Global South is not the answer. All this will do is effectively perpetuate the cycle of poverty, exploitation, perpetrate lacks of health services, lack of education for the poorest of the poor. Sean, the issues arising from the traffic congestion is exactly why the governments in the Global South should not be actively discouraging rapid urbanization. As my teammate Luke has already talked about, the Via Verde project and many modern cities are using green technologies in order to improve air quality. Governments in the Global South need to plan for the future by investing in public transport, reducing or indeed banning single-use vehicles in single-populated areas. Elise, do you expect them to stay in their remote and rural villages? You seem very worried about the environment, but not the people in it. We cannot stop the tidal wave of urbanization, as my teammates and I firmly stated. The prop should encourage the world governments to respond now instead of acting later to the tsunami of problems that will come from neglecting the issues of the Global South. Rapid urbanization in the Global South will bring forth huge advancements if managed properly, and it's not necessary to destroy the planet in the process. Echoing Luke, in the words of the infamous Benjamin Franklin, fail to plan, plan to fail. Knowledge is power. Thank you.
Kian, did you know that 6 of the 7 fastest growing economies in the 2000s were in Africa? Eve, did you know that according to the African Transformation Report in 2021, Africa is expected to be the fastest growing economic region for the next 20 years? Global GDP is estimated to grow by 2.4%, but in Africa's GDP is expected to grow by 5%. However, according to the African Transformation Report in 2021, this economic growth is not enough as it does not automatically result in job creation. Economic growth is not enough as it does not automatically give people skills and education. Economic growth is not enough as it does not necessarily spread prosperity. My teammate Luke has already brought to your attention that Africa is lagging behind other countries in the global south due to poor policy planning and infrastructure. Sean, Elise, Africa needs economic transformation and well-managed urbanization is an integral part of achieving this economic prosperity. Kian, Eve, KY Amoako, founder and president of the African Center for Economic Transformation, has identified 3 challenges facing Africa's economic transformation. 1, job creation. Ensuring jobs for the world's youngest and fastest growing labor force by imparting skills for work in the 21st century, agriculture, manufacturing, and services. Elise, how is disincentivizing people from living in cities going to address this challenge? 2, innovation. Supporting digital innovation by enabling the private sector to deliver the many benefits from digital technologies in creating jobs, boosting productivity, and reducing poverty. Sean, how does discouraging urbanization going to address these challenges posed by an inadequate digital framework? Eve, did you know that 300 million Africans live more than 50 kilometers from a fiber or cable broadband connection, a significant impediment to the modern way of living? Managing climate risk by promoting climate smart agriculture, protecting green and blue ecosystems, and exploiting renewable energy sources. Elise, how does actively discouraging urbanization help to address the challenges posed by the climate crisis? Elise, my teammate Luke has already asserted that high population density can, if managed properly, also be good for minimizing the effect of man on local ecosystems. High population density typically implies lower per capita cost of providing infrastructure and basic services. My teammate Shane spoke about how problems regarding sanitation in densely populated urban areas should be used to fuel economic prosperity and that human waste could be used to create energy, thereby making fossil fuels redundant. My teammate Megan has already spoken about the importance of education, how if well managed, increasing urbanization can dramatically increase the educational opportunities for young people. In South Sudan, 52% of girls are married before the age of 18. By actively discouraging urbanization, you are encouraging parochialism and tribalism. Sean, you are correct. We can learn from the mistakes of the past. But what is your solution? What do you propose? How do you suggest we provide the services to the people who need it? Ladies and gentlemen, adjudicators, the Nigerian writer Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie in her writing warns against a single story of Africa, a single story of catastrophe. This motion is retrogressive. You can't stop the waves, but you can learn to surf. It's a famous saying by Jon Kabat-Zinn, and this is what the governments in the Global South should be doing by not actively discouraging rapid urbanization, but rather putting in place social, health, digital, educational infrastructure that will drive economic transformation and economic growth and prosperity in the Global South. As rebuttal, people whose homes are wiped out by tsunamis and other natural disasters have no choice but to relocate in cities to find a new way to live. How exactly are you going to stop people coming into cities? You can't stop the tidal wave, but we can be prepared. Thank you.
Ahuina Ushla, I'm sure at this late juncture in proceedings that you're all of one mind with us when we say the unplanned and uncontrolled expansion of cities brings profound social, environmental, and health risks. The opposition keep mentioning that we're discouraging urbanization. We are discouraging rapid urbanization. They constantly mention planned infrastructure, but rapid urbanization is ad hoc, unplanned, uncontrolled, and dangerous. This is why it must be discouraged. More often than not during this debate, I felt the opposition were fighting our corner. They were highlighting all the issues surrounding rapid urbanization. Claire, you mentioned millennial development. That's outdated. We've moved on to the sustainable development goals. Also, you failed to comprehend a simple economic concept, economic growth versus economic development. They're two completely different things. My teammate Sean has illustrated that rapid urbanization is not managed. So Luke, how can you tell me that it's controlled and planned? To quote you, Luke, they have time. You've completely missed the point of the motion. The key word of this motion is rapid urbanization, implying that they do not have time. Megan, you may argue that the increase in wealth can be spent on education, etc. Yet, ladies and gentlemen, for rapid urbanization to be successful and for the said country to not go into poverty, the country has to invest in education before rapid urbanization occurs. And that's according to the United Nations. Megan, you mentioned how children in developing countries have not got access to a playground or safe environment. But it is because of these rubbish dumps with toxic waste and broken glass that you mentioned that they are the direct consequence of rapid urbanization. Shane, plan in advance? Again, rapid urbanization is unplanned. Shane, we're not discouraging urbanization. We're discouraging rapid urbanization. Also, we suggest you re-watch this recording at a later date to catch all of Eve's many solutions that she offered. Ahuina Ushla, I believe the opposition has indulged in unsubstantiated platitudes. Were they lulling us by false representation? I believe they were. We emphatically refute their argument. Ladies and gentlemen, it is clear that rapid urbanization leads to countless health issues and preventable deaths. And I believe that everyone can agree that this shouldn't be encouraged by governments. We urge you to propose this motion. Gurmila Maglev.
I would like to thank both teams for their participation here today. We now invite both teams to take a 15-minute break while the adjudicators discuss the results.
Thank you, everyone. Welcome back to our semi-final today. I would like to invite our chief adjudicator, Jennifer Gillen, to offer the results and the feedback for both teams.
Hello, everyone. I won't make this too long because I know you're dying to hear the results. But first, I would just like to congratulate both teams wholeheartedly because it was an incredible standard of debating. I haven't done one of these in a while, and every time I come back, I'm just floored every time. So I'll just run through a little bit of feedback from all the adjudicators. One of the few of the positives, there was one thing that stood out was just the quality of sources used, which you don't get in every debate. And just on that note, even though there were excellent sources used, some URLs were cited, and myself and the other adjudicators were just discussing, like, if you're doing some research on a website, maybe it's there could be more sources kind of listed at the bottom of an article, so that you're not kind of giving a .co.uk or a .com, just sounds a little bit better. One other thing was that there was a really strong display of teamwork across both teams, and actually different approaches to teamwork. And it was very highly scored, which is usually a neglected portion of the marking sheet. So on one team, the proposition, they did a lot of referring back and forth to each other, reinforcing each other's arguments, which we really liked. And then the opposition had a lovely mantra running through each speech, which really helped tie the arguments together. And we have a standout quote from one of the adjudicators was for a tree, wearing a mask was an option. So really liked little elements like that mix stats with examples, case studies, anecdotal evidence, and just to make sure in your speeches, if you want to, one thing I used to do was give the speech to someone who's never heard of the topic, has no knowledge on the topic, and see what they take away from it. And often, a person hearing your speech for the first time can take away all the statistics. So I would go back then and kind of intersperse my statistics with anecdotal evidence, et cetera, so you're not overloading the audience members with numbers all at once. A few other areas to work on is just having flexibility with the speeches. And it's something that comes just with time and as many debates as possible. I don't know how many you need to do before it never gets perfect, but just to account for varying interpretations of the motion. Because, I had this happen in plenty of my own debates as well, where each team will interpret the motion slightly differently, and you have to be able to adjust your speech as the debate goes on to account for those different perspectives from your opposition. And then just on a rebuttals front, we actually all agreed that there was a really strong attempt at rebuttals, and that's a testament to how far you've both come in this competition. But just in the future, the best rebuttals we find are the ones that are backed up with source material. And even if you're going to refer to a team member and a point that they've already made, it's no harm to restate the point that they've made, just so it doesn't continue and you lose time further down in speeches. Just to make sure to engage with the entirety of the motion. I think in this debate, we lost a little bit of the nuance of, in your research links, there was a big argument for kind of a ruralization, which we didn't hear about at all. And it would have been, I think, an interesting topic to discuss. Yeah, really, really interesting, unique points from both sides. The standard of delivery was extremely high, just from an oratory point of view, very, very engaging. So that's all the feedback from me. So finally, I just want to say that it wasn't a unanimous decision, and it was very close. So by a very narrow margin, the motion was defeated. So congratulations to Ballyborough Community School. Yeah, congratulations to both teams. Really an excellent debate, and thank you all for participating today.